bastant interès tot el conflicte de Standing Rock, sobretot l'any passat i sobretot en el moment més crític, que va ser la tardor i el desembre, fins que es va resoldre provisionalment amb la suspensió del projecte a l'últim mes del mandat d'Obama. I tothom es va fer una petita campanya d'organitzacions i persones a nivell internacional per demanar que els 17 o 18 bancs, entre els quals el BBVA d'aquí a l'estat espanyol, que estaven finançant el projecte, retiressin la inversió. I doncs ara fa dos mesos es va assabentar que hi havia un grup de suport a la campanya, de la campanya de Standing Rock, d'acord amb altres organitzacions europees, estava fent una gira o planificava fer una gira a tota Europa. De tal manera que, diguéssim, ens vam posar d'acord i els vam demanar que, a més de la gira que tenien prevista, fessin una petita extensió aquí a l'estat espanyol que no tenien previst. El company Natani, que després parlarem amb ell, ha estat a Madrid, hi ha un altre company que ha estat a Bilbao aquests dies també. Ell ja marxa demà passat cap a casa, que em sembla que té ja bastantes ganes perquè porta un mes per aquí. I van dir-vos que en Natani Mins és activista, ha estat durant tota aquesta campanya en el lloc dels fets. És fill de Russell Mins, un dels líders indígenes que van recordar el centenari de Wantanamie, diguéssim, que es va mobilitzar i que és un líder històric del moviment indígena dels Estats Units. A més, és artista, demà a les 7 també a la Casa de la Solidaritat per, diguéssim, una sessió més lúdica, diguéssim, musical de hip-hop, en què ell participarà. Però avui, diguéssim, és la part una mica més de debat i perquè ell ens pugui explicar i puguem fer un diàleg amb ell, tenir l'oportunitat, diguéssim, que ell és aquí per conèixer-ho més de prop, diguéssim, no només el que està la lluita d'estar dintre, el que és la lluita dels pobles indis a Nord-Amèrica i, com ens ha comentat, doncs, tots els projectes, diguéssim, els megaprojectes, diguéssim, petrolers, oleoductes, etcètera, que darrere estan dintre, que estan planejats i molt més accelerats en aquest nou mandat de Donald Trump. Aleshores, sense més, jo li dono la paraula a Natani i a partir d'aquí, després, quan ell acabi, farem un debat. Li podeu preguntar tot el que vulgueu. Natani?
Can you hear me? Oh, very well. Hello, my name is Natani Chante Kostin, Nape Chi Zabalo. Natani Nez Means, Ma Chapalo. Hello, everybody. I greet you with a good heart and a handshake. My name is Natani Nez Means. I'm Oglala Lakota on my father's side. I'm also the Hanthama Dakota. And my mother's side, I am Dene and Omaha, pronounced Umaha, from the eastern side of Nebraska. That day, after the construction equipment went in and they started to tear through the earth, four women, one that was included on this tour, and her name was Washtewi, she was with us on this tour. She's my cousin, actually. She's really like my sister. I'm supposed to address her as a sister. Her and my dad adopted each other as Hunka, brother and sister. When he adopts them as a Hunka, that's closer than blood, it's spiritual. So the next day after, or the day that they shut ground, four women ran out and got in the way of the bulldozers and stopped construction. And from that point on, the camp which was small then. There's only a few hundred people, and they were all Lakota. There's a history about that land that we're camped on. Standing Rock Sioux Tribe is the nearest reservation that's next to the pipeline. They would be first affected, their community. I think there's eight small communities within that reservation. Next would be the people that are on the other side of the river, who are white people. The next downstream would be the Cheyenne River Indian Sioux Reservation. They would be the next affected. I was in the Ochetse Chacon camp that was located across the Cannonball River, which was off reservation land. We were not on Standing Rock Indian Reservation. We were on what we call treaty land. In 1851 and in 1868, there was a treaty established with the United States of America after we repeatedly kept beating them in warfare, and they begged us for peace. They begged us for a solution, so we gave it to them. Because in our way of life, our original way of life, we know no concept of lying. There's no concept to lying, of saying something and not going through with it. That's our old mentality. Anyway, we made these treaties. And ever since 1851 and 1868, those treaties have been broken continuously by the United States of America. And in Article 2, Section 4, either Article 2, Section 4, or Article 4, Section 2. I'm kind of dyslexic. it's one of those. It states that the United States of America honors treaties made foreign and domestic, that treaties are the supreme law of the land, yet they have not honored one single treaty with any indigenous nation in what is now the United States of America. We refer to it as Turtle Island. So when these camps were established, we made a treaty stand. We didn't only stand for the water, we made a treaty stand, and we made a human rights stand. We fought hard to be on that land, and once you make a treaty stand, it opens up a can of worms for the United States. It's like, they can't. If they decide to honor one treaty now, they have to retract everything and honor everybody's treaty. It's like, something they really just can't cut, like, they have no will to do it, I guess. So, from August until early September, there were continuous marches that would go up to what was the construction site then, and the camp was becoming established, and ideas were being thrown around, and things were happening in the camps and on the pipeline. What kind of strategic measures were to take place, and what was the tribe? What was the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe going to do legally, and versus what? Versus what people in the camps wanted to do right there on the front line to stop construction. On September 3rd of 2016, there was an incident between Dakota Access Pipeline Security and the protectors. I was there that day. There was a women's march that was going up to what was the construction site then. And we found out just over the hill from that first construction site, they had rerouted their original route, and they were doing construction up there. everybody went up there. We stopped construction, we turned the bulldozers around, and the Dakota Access Pipeline security brought dogs out on us. Attack dogs. They didn't seem to be trained very well, as they were very frantic, and at one point they released their dogs on us. They released several dogs on us. And it was like I couldn't believe it was 2017, you know, and they're doing this to us. I watched a woman get bit on her breast and dragged down by a dog. I took action. You know, we did what we could to protect ourselves in that case. One dog grabbed a horse on the side of its belly and ripped a piece of its skin off. So the first violent encounter was initiated by Dakota Access Pipeline security. The police were over the hill watching as everything was happening. We saw them. They didn't protect us. From day one, they didn't protect us. There's a thing to be known about the United States of America, you know, people die every day from police violence. American Indian people are the most likely to be killed and are being killed at a faster rate than any other ethnicity per capita. We are dying at a faster rate than any other race per capita. As of the 2010 census, we make up 0.8 the population in our own country. Now sit with that for a second. We make up 0.8, not even a 1% in our own land, yet we are the fastest and most likely to be killed by police. You can understand how real it was for us to go against that police. On October 27th, the last video that you've seen, I was arrested that day. There's a lot about that day I choose not to remember, but I put that in the back of my mind just to keep moving forward, you know? There's a lot of pain that happened, not just on me, but on my people. My women, my children. I watched as confusion spread among my people because of poor leadership. People got hurt because of poor leadership. And we were arrested because of poor leadership. Us young people, we did what we could that day to hold off the police, to make sure they didn't hurt anybody. That day they used this weapon called an LRAD, and it's off these sound waves. These sound waves that if you stand in the way long enough, it feels like it's cooking your skin. Turns your insides. Makes you feel it in the insides, like a microwave. High-pitched noises, ooh, you hear it. That day they killed a horse. I believe it was in that video when they let out that first shot. I think a horse got hit point blank by a concussion grenade or by a tear gas canister and it died there. That's an act of war against us. Killed one of our horses. I watched them that day. These men were in ceremony at a purification lodge. The police went and dragged them out, hogtied them, put their underwear on, and didn't let them get dressed. When we arrived, they have these dog kennels set up. So they processed us through them. They stuffed us all in these dog kennels. By the time my sister Washgami was arrested in February, they had this poster up in the dog kennels that they put us in when they would process us into the jails. And it said, American dog breeds. That's what the police thought of us. This is racist North Dakota. We were always continually harassed by Dakota Access Pipeline security. We were antagonized. We were infiltrated heavily. There is a report that came out by TheIntercept.com that released reports via public records that Dakota Access Pipeline hired private security Tiger Swan, which was established at the height of the Iraq War. Tiger Swan is a branch from what is formerly known as Blackwater. In these public reports, they're out there. You can look at TheIntercept.com. These reports that are given from security to the police, they refer to us as extremist terrorist jihadists or jihadists. And to deal with us like them. They also told police not to kill anyone because it would be detrimental to the pipeline, but to do everything else. We were in occupation. There was constant surveillance. There was a plane and a helicopter. Sometimes there'd be two helicopters, one plane. Sometimes there'd be two planes and one helicopter. Sometimes there'd be both, four of them, one. Constantly, 24/7. To not hear the plane or the helicopter, that was weird. That's how used to it we got. They also put Standing Rock Indian Reservation in an economic embargo. They cut off the road after October 27th at the bridge. This bridge is known as Backwater Bridge. They had different tiers and blockades set up. There was also that night that they shut the bridge down. There has been since a whistleblower that worked for DAPL Security. I forget her name, but she came out last week and exposed the Dakota Access Pipeline and their tactics, saying that night there were these 2 5-ton trucks that were parked on the bridge and they set them on fire. People were very skeptical about who said they thought a certain camp set it on fire, set those trucks on fire during the night. But no, it was DAPL Security to make it look like we did. So they cut off the roads. This main road to Bismarck, where the Standing Rock Sioux tribe, if there's any kind of hospital emergency, someone needs surgery, someone's having a baby, someone's having a heart attack, you know, Standing Rock Sioux tribe doesn't have the biggest hospital. It's not big at all. It's tiny. It's smaller than this room, really. Their main road was cut off to those emergency services. They had to go around, which would take an extra 30, 40 minutes. That's the road we had to take. We had to take it around. And it was a farm road. And it was scary in the winter. Icy. And there was one point. Oh, I'm sorry. There was that one point. The North Dakota governor had told emergency services to not salt the road during the snowstorms and to not clear off the snowdrifts. There were snowdrifts this high on the road. People had to go in and out, weave around them with the road icy. It would get as low as -40 degrees Celsius It'll be that cold. And we would have to drive to the nearest town, Bismarck, North Dakota, Mandan, North Dakota, through all of that icy roads and snow drifts. That's what the North Dakota governor thought of the Standing Rock Sioux tribe. Some of these members of this tribe, they never even set foot in the camp. Yet they were being punished. Bad Indians. So it caused division between the people that lived there on the reservation and the people that lived in the camps. It caused division. It caused a lot of tension. Protesters need to go home. Protesters need to leave. So on December 5th, December 4th, he was talking about when Obama denied the easement for them to drill and bore underneath the river, when he thought it was a victory. I didn't think it was a victory. A lot of people didn't that day. One, we were pleading with Obama since August. The youth even ran from Standing Rock all the way to Washington, D.C. They ran 2,000 miles. Obama didn't listen. Obama visited the Standing Rock Sioux tribe 2 years prior to that. He went in their powwow. And him and Michelle Obama promised on video that they would take care of their youth. And there was youth there that spoke to Obama when he told them that. I got you guys. I'll take care of you. Don't worry. August, there's nothing from Obama. September, there's nothing. October, I think he was asked on a trip to Laos about the Dakota Access Pipeline. And that's the first time he addressed it in a whole other country on the other side of the world. And he ran around the question. So, we know that when he denied it, it was to save face, it was to save himself, you know? It wasn't for us because people were hurt by then. People, Sophia Wolanski had already basically lost her arm. She's in recovery now. They had to take ligaments from her leg to put in her arm after a flash grenade blew up next to her on November 22nd, the night they were spraying everybody with water cannons and sub-freezing temperature. She had to have whole reconstructive surgery on her arm. That night, another woman was shot in the eye. She lost her sight in this eye. She wears sunglasses now forever. She can't see out of this eye. People have lost fingers just for reporting the police. They've been shot in their hands. That night, they were pointing at men's genitals. I remember my friend saying that. These are the things I remember. Things I lived through while we're up there. So once Trump reinstated the Dakota Access Pipeline, as well as the Keystone XL, which we thought was defeated 2 years prior, he approved both pipelines that carry tar sands crude oil. One carries tar sands crude oil, one carries the Bakken oil. You know, prior to this, Winona LaDuke and All of the Earth, you know, they had victories. They defeated Line 2 in Minnesota. Since then, now, Line 3 is introduced. And they're trying to make that go through Minnesota. Enbridge has another mine coming from British Columbia. Another one has been trying to be constructed in northern British Columbia on Unistoten land. There's a camp up there that they're withholding the Dene people, D-E-N-E, Dene people. I met with those people while I was in Canada. They've been fighting that for 10 years now, almost 9 years. So we're urging them to pull their money out. And we're shaming them. That's the big thing they don't like, is to be shamed publicly. You know, they want to remain a good name, someone they can trust, someone you can trust. And people always ask us, what can we do to help you? This is what you can do. You can continue to shame these banks until they pull their money out. But you can also continue to look up your local fights. Like, I understand there's a gas pipeline that's proposed to come from Algeria through Barcelona and deliver natural gas to France. You know, these are things you can lend a hand in and fight and become, have people come become aware. The no TAP pipeline that is in southern Italy. You know, there's a lot of things that are happening in Europe. I understand Germany in a few years will become nuclear power free. Yet they're still operating one of the largest coal mines in Europe, which is one of the dirtiest ways to create energy. So there's things here you can do to help save our one planet from annihilating us. You know. So thank you guys for your time, for your ear, for your attention, for coming here because you didn't have to. It's very easy not to do things. I appreciate you guys for doing this. In a few days, I get to go home. I get to be with my family and see my people, and I'm very excited for that. And to be back in my homelands, where I know the land. This is your homeland. This comes from this side of the world. At one point in time, you were or are indigenous to this land. Think about that. It's a beautiful thing. Reconnect. Reconnect with the land. I was driving, we were taking the train all the way from my hood to here. And I was looking at these mountains and I was just like, dang, I wonder what power that mountain has. I wonder what kind of power this place has. I wonder what kind of spirits are here. I wonder what this and this and this and that. You know, reconnect. Because at one point in time, you come from indigenous people, you know? Like John Trudell said in that one video, indigenous people, it's come full circle to us, it's colonization. We've had to deal with it for 500 years. The people that come from Africa, they've had to deal with it from that amount of time in our country, but in their own country, they've dealt with it longer. The white people have dealt with it for thousands of years. That's what he said in that. So thank you guys. And remember that you have influence on two people. So reach out to those two people. And I guess next we'll just take some questions, right?
Good to see you.